In these last 20 years, they have made it difficult for men and women like that first group in 1954 to become leaders. They started to silence us, the people. They took away our vote because they said we had to vote for groups. They said they would have to reconsider whether the one man, one vote system was good for Singapore. They put people in jail because they disagreed with them. And they tortured them. They sent others into exile, and they bankrupted others, and they tried to intimidate all of us. They frightened us. They made us believe that if you speak up about what you see around you, if you help your fellow citizens who were in trouble, like Teo So Lang did, you would end up like Teo So Lang, tortured in a prison. And why? Because there are only two ways to run a country. By making yourself worthy of the people, or by making yourself too powerful to change. They chose the second in these last 5 years. Today, our country, one of the richest in the world, is a place where old people beg for food. Today, our country is a place where our people no longer talk to their neighbors. Our country is a place where there are no more brave men like the brave men of 1954. My friends, in these last few months, people have come up to us to thank us for speaking up for them, to thank us for being brave. And I have struggled to understand them because I am not brave. I am not doing anything extraordinary. I am only doing what every Singaporean has the right to do. To say to our leaders, with respect, you have lost your way. You have forgotten the people. You have turned a deaf ear against our cries of frustration. Because deep down in our hearts, rich or poor, comfortable or insecure, we sense that we only live half a life. And looking into your eyes, into the frustration of the people, I now know why you think I'm brave. Because the PAP has succeeded, or almost succeeded, in taking our humanity away from us. We are prepared to forget everything that makes us human, everything that gives us hope, everything that makes us happy, in return for just not being afraid. And so when you thank me and my colleagues, what you are actually saying is thank you for reminding me of what it means to be human. Thank you that I no longer feel frightened. My friends, there are two ways to govern a nation. At one time, the PAP made our lives better, the first way. Today, it has almost succeeded in making us silent, making us frightened, the second way. But the people of Singapore, you are waking up. We are remembering what it means to be human, what it means to live. And so we see in these last few months, they have tried various tactics. First, they offered us money. Then they tried to smear your candidates by saying we were not fit to be your representatives. Then they offered you upgrading. Then, when you clearly said to them that what they were giving you was what you didn't want, they went on TV and they cried. And yesterday, they tried to portray themselves as ordinary, normal Singaporeans. And today the Prime Minister tells us he's sorry. My friends, what are they sorry for? Are they sorry for putting 200 people in jail who didn't commit a crime? Are they sorry for torturing them? Are they sorry for bankrupting J.B. Jeyaretnam and humiliating President Ong Teng Cheong? Are they sorry for for losing hundreds of millions of our dollars? Is Dr. Balakrishnan sorry for squandering $200 million and then refusing to explain why? Is Mr. Teo Ho Pin sorry for losing 2 million of your conservancy charges? Are they sorry for calling 600,000 salary peanuts? Are they sorry because they have no idea how to deal with floods? And are they sorry for insulting the native people of our land, our Malay brothers and sisters? Are they sorry for packing our nation with 7,000 people in every square kilometer? Are they sorry that old people cannot eat and families cannot go to the doctor? And are they sorry that 70,000 children go to school without pocket money every day? Or are they sorry that they have grabbed millions of dollars every year in salaries? They said that their salaries are pegged to the highest earners in the private sector. But they forgot to remember that in the private sector, if a CEO doesn't perform in 3 to 5 years, the shareholders get him out. The CEO doesn't change the rules of the company so that they put you in jail if you try to get him out. Today, we are not impressed by their apology. We are not impressed by their remorse. It is contemptuous in the extreme. We want good government. A government that listens. A government that cares for us, the people. Today, though, there is a groundswell of change. Slowly, like an earthquake preparing to erupt, I can hear the hearts and minds of you, the people, waking up, saying, enough is enough. My friends, change starts with something small. One idea, one event, one person. Change comes very slowly, but change comes. Change comes because we suddenly remember our common humanity and we reclaim our outrage and we say, enough. The PAP has tried to win this election by their usual methods, smear campaigns, fear, and throwing money at you. And in these last few years, they have tried tears and regret. But you will also see that they have been responding to the questions posed to them by the opposition parties. Even before you have put us in parliament, we are already doing the job that an MP should be doing. Which is to ask the difficult questions and not let them get away by saying it is none of our business why they have squandered our money. Questions like why our young couples cannot afford a flat. Questions like why you are not doing anything about the rising prices that you have caused. Questions like why we should trust you when you insult us and offend us and tell us we need to be kicked in order to work faster, better, and cheaper. Questions like why you are not listening to the people. The opposition parties in these last few days have brought the PAP out from their shelter where they have hidden from you. And we have made them face you, the people. And so, as Teo So Lang said yesterday in Bukit Panjang, the opposition is already in parliament. All you need to do is put your cross on Saturday. stage, I would like to clarify one or two matters of our policy that I understand Mr. Christopher D'Souza is speaking about at his rally. Mr. D'Souza has suggested that our economic plans are unworkable. Other members of his party said they are cobbled together. And even as we speak, they are misrepresenting our plans to you, the people. Mr. D'Souza, if I may remind you, is a lawyer, whereas the SDP team that developed our proposals are policy analysts like myself, academics like Dr. Gomez and Mr. Tan, and Mr. Tan Jisei, who is a highly experienced economist. So let me clarify 2 points with you. The first being about income tax. We have asked the question in our manifesto, how is it possible that countries like Germany, Sweden, and Japan, who have income tax brackets at the highest level of 30% or close to 30%, how is it that they are able to provide such good services for their people and assure wealth for the various strata of their people? We ask this question and we propose a more equitable raising of income tax so that everybody benefits. It is not acceptable for some people to be earning in the millions of dollars and some people to earn $500 a month. I also want to remind the VAP from this place that our plans were not cobbled together and they were not plans that are unworkable. They are plans that someone as experienced as Lord Butler, the head of the British civil service under three British prime ministers, has commended not just as being workable, but he has recommended that PAP policymakers should take a look at that plan. And I also ask them, have they given you a national regeneration plan like Jisei has done? Did they give you a health plan like Dr. Gomez has done? Have they given you a shadow budget that refocuses resources on the people rather than on defense? We have seen money, tears, and a cynical apology. We want none of that. We want our country back. We want to travel the world proud to say, I am a Singaporean. And on Saturday, my friends, something magical will happen. You will go to a place, and by the simple and non-violent act of putting a cross in pencil next to a name, you will decide who will govern our country for the next 5 years. It is an act we should remember. People died to secure for us. It is an act that makes us human. It is an act more important than anything you will do in the next 5 years because it will ensure a safe, secure, and prosperous home for your children. Cast your vote for your children. Do not find yourself in a position another 25 years from now when they will say to you, why did you not speak up for me? This is the responsibility you carry with you on Saturday. I ask you to carry it with care. And my message to you is the same message that I have given all the days of this campaign. Let us move confidently into the future, our children's future, with no one left behind. Thank you.